Welcome back, everybody. This is Earth and Space Science 102. I'm Stephanie Welch, and today we're going to talk about, in two segments, the life stages of a star. We'll talk about how stars form, how they are created, how they live out their lives, in a sense, how they're ultimately destroyed, and what gets left behind after a star dies. So one of the things to concentrate on is this idea that almost everything in the universe has a cycle, has a life story to it, and nothing has a longer life story than stars, especially the ones that we're going to talk about first, because the first of these two lectures is going to be all about low-mass stars. Now, our sun, even though it appears really bright to us, would fall into this category of being a relatively low-mass star. The first thing I want to do is take a look at these stars on something called the HR diagram that we introduced in the last lecture. This is the very end of lecture 20. On the HR diagram, we take the two easiest to figure out variables of a star, the two easiest properties to determine, and we graph them against each other. And when we do that, we pick out certain trends. Take, for instance, how temperature and luminosity, or the true brightness of a star, are going to be related to each other, particularly for stars that are in sort of a normal part of their overall lifespan. So on an HR diagram, like the one you can see now, the luminosity of a star is plotted on the y-axis. The spectral type, or surface temperature, is plotted on the x-axis, the horizontal axis. And when you do this, you find that temperature actually increases from right to left instead of the direction you'd expect it to increase. That means that the relationship among what we call main sequence stars plays out right down the middle of the graph from the very lower right to the upper left corner. These main sequence stars are laid out according to temperature and luminosity, but they are also going to relate back to mass. Only a high mass star is going to be very, very luminous and at a really, really high surface temperature. Only a very, very dim and low temperature star, a fairly cool star, is going to plot way down on the bottom. That's going to be a relatively low mass star. Now, it's maybe a little disingenuous to even put these into only two categories when you can see that they fall out along a large spectrum, but for ease of explaining their entire life story, that's what we're going to do. We're going to take all of the stars, the billions and billions and billions of stars that you can see out there in the sky, and even the ones that we can't see, we're going to take these and lay them out on the HR diagram and put them into two solid little categories, low mass and high mass. To give you an idea of just, you know, how much this kind of constrains us, imagine trying to take everybody in the world and classify them as either being fat or thin. You know, most people would fall out somewhere along that spectrum, along that gradient. But that's what we're doing with stars. Low-mass stars, like our sun, and high-mass stars that we're going to get into in the next lecture. The low-mass stars have spectral types like M, K, G, and F, and they're going to fall on the lower right-hand side of the diagram. They're going to have a certain life story. They're going to play out in a certain way, undergo a certain type of fusion, and ultimately end their days as a very compact, dense object that we're going to get into a little bit later. The high-mass stars have an even more interesting overall life story, and that's what we're going to get into in the next lecture. So today's lecture is all about specifically low-mass stars, and the next lecture, that's when we're going to get into high-mass stars. So for a low-mass star like our sun, when it forms, it is going to initially be a main-sequence star. But there's also going to be a part of the star's overall life story that's going to be post-main sequence and post-hydrogen fusion. There's even going to be a part of the star's overall life story that's going to be after fusion has stopped altogether and gravity takes over. So this version of the HR diagram that you can see now shows you how temperature and luminosity of that star will change throughout its overall lifespan, but it will spend the greatest amount of time being a main sequence star and converting hydrogen into helium.
So this is just something I wanted to show you just to kind of get us started today, to know that temperature and luminosity are going to be variable, even though mass is not variable. So the temperature and the luminosity are only going to really be consistent while the star is in that part of its overall lifespan that we call a main sequence star. Now, to break this down and try to make it as easy as possible to follow, I've given you a little bit of an outline for how we're going to look at the life stages of a low-mass star, and I'll give you a very similar outline for how we're going to look at the life stages of a high-mass star. While they start off very similar, they're going to deviate, the low-mass stars versus the high-mass stars, in the extent of their main sequence lifetime, the extent of their post-main sequence lifetime, and how they ultimately end their days. So mass really is the most crucial, the most important characteristic of a star. Now, the first of these stages that we're going to talk about is how stars initially form. This is going to be very, very similar to a subject that we already covered a little bit earlier in the semester when we talked about how the solar system formed. But we're going to have even more emphasis on just the formation of our star in this lecture and all the other stars. So that's the first step, how stars originate, nebular collapse, and how that leads to heat, and how that heat is important for the next phase. The next phase, after this collapse continues to a certain point, is the main sequence part of a star's lifetime. And for a low-mass star like our Sun, that main sequence lifetime is going to be extremely long, 2,000 times longer for a similar high-mass star. And we'll talk about why that is. The third step is going to be the post-main sequence lifetime. Ultimately, any star, whether it is the lowest mass or the highest mass star, will run out of hydrogen in the part of the star where fusion is taking place. And that's when all kinds of weird things are going to happen. This is almost sort of like the death row stage of a star's lifespan. Finally, we'll look at the corpse left behind, the stellar corpse left behind in the terms of a low-mass star, and we'll see how that compares at the very end of the lecture today to how high-mass stars end their days. Stellar death for a low-mass star involves the formation of a nebula, a similar nebula to the way that a star will form in the first place. So there's this beautiful reincarnation to the whole cycle, in a sense. And much of the star's mass gets tied up in this really dense object, this post-fusion object called a white dwarf. So this picture kind of lays out the entire overall cycle and even shows you how it's a cycle that can then start back over again. You start off with this cloud of gas and dust in space called a nebula or an interstellar cloud. For our purposes, you could just use those interchangeably. It's just the gas and dust that exists between solar systems in a galaxy like our own, maybe in the spiral arms of a galaxy like our own Milky Way galaxy. That gas will collapse in on itself, form ultimately a main sequence star. Jets of matter will be ejected out of its rotationary axis just before the main sequence stage. That main sequence lifetime lasts for a really, really, really long time, where fusion and gravity are these equal combatants against each other. And then you get into this post-main sequence lifetime with the expansion of the star into one or more of these giant phases before the star ultimately implodes and explodes at the same time, forming a nebula. And from that nebula, a new star can form, and much of that dense material in the core is left behind as a white dwarf. So let's look at the very first stage of that, what we're going to call step one, the origin of stars. Nebular collapse generates heat. So what you start off with is a rather cool field of gas and dust in space. And you need some trigger to get that gas to start to collapse in on itself. For our own star in our own solar system, it was probably some distant supernova, the explosion of some high-mass star out there in the universe. And the shockwave from that event maybe, possibly, allowed our nebula to start to collapse in on itself, started to clump up in one place. And the ultimate result of that would be the formation of a star. Collisions between particles generate planets, and then you have a stable system for billions of years. So it all starts with a nebula, like the Orion Nebula pictured here that you can see, or the Pillars of Creation, or the Ring Nebula. There are all of these beautiful, beautiful nebulas that we can see out there in the universe, far beyond our own solar system. And the reason why we can see them is because, at least initially, they're rather hot, as being the result of the death throes of a star. When that explosion sends all that gas reeling back out into the universe, it's hot for a while. And because it's hot, it's highly visible gas, ionized. And so these are some of the most beautiful astronomical objects that we can see, these nebulas. These nebulas then, for reasons that might relate to something like a distant supernova, start to collapse inwards on themselves, start to clump up in places, and wherever that collapse will allow gravity to drive this material inwards, that is where a new star will form. So you can see all the little clumps in the Orion Nebula, and each one of those little clumps where gravity's taken over and the material starts to spiral inwards, that's where a new star will ultimately be born. So this cloud can generate lots and lots and lots of stars, and the number of stars that it can ultimately generate is dependent upon the mass of that big gas cloud in space. It collapses in on itself, each one rotating inward, so that the two conservation laws are still as important as they were when we were talking about the formation of the solar system. The conservation of angular momentum, meaning this is going to spin faster and faster and faster as it collapses inwards, and collisions between particles are going to allow this big sort a diffuse cloud to condense down into a disk, and the conservation of energy. The conservation of energy is probably the most important here in actually forming a star like our sun, because that's the source of heat that allows fusion to ultimately be taking place later on. In the beginning, you have this big diffuse cold gas cloud in space, but once it collapses in on itself, energy is neither created nor destroyed, it's retained. It's just converted into a different form. Gravitational potential energy of this big diffuse gas cloud gets converted into, ultimately, thermal energy. It gets converted into heat, and the nebula heats up as it continues to collapse, driving the core temperatures higher and higher and higher and higher, until one of two things has to happen. Gravity continues indefinitely, and you collapse this material as far as that material can be collapsed down to, or fusion begins. And with the onset of fusion, you have this external force, this force that's pushing outwards, that's combating the internal collapse of gravity. Now, right before fusion starts, something really interesting and highly beautiful happens to a star. This is the labor pains of a star right before it's born. Because you have this rotating gas cloud, all of this gas is rotating inwards continually, you have a rotationary axis, similar to the Earth's rotationary axis. We spin around an imaginary line. So too did the solar system. So out of that rotationary axis, jets of matter are going to be ejected out into space. And this is sort of a signal that fusion is about to take place. This is something that we can see happening as new stars are born out there in the universe. So the picture on the right shows you this actually spinning accretionary disk, where all of that material, all that gas is continuing to collapse inwards. And that line of material that you can see going up on the slide, on the red picture on the right, is the jet of matter that's being ejected out of that rotationary axis, or along that rotationary axis. So this protostar, and that's the name that we give the star that's right almost at the point of allowing for fusion to begin, will continue to collapse and continue to collapse, again, until gravity just crushes this thing inwards even more, or fusion begins. So as long as you have enough material there, then you have a high enough density to have a high enough temperature so that fusion will ultimately take place. And when it does, something amazing happens. For some period of time, never forever, but for some period of time, the star regains its stability. So you can imagine maybe everything in the universe is constantly subjected to the force of gravity. Gravity is this force that's constantly crushing objects in space, but some objects can withstand that crush of gravity, at least for some short period of time. And stars are one of those objects that have the ability to be able to do that. Stars can combat the internal collapse of gravity, at least stave it off or hold it off for a while, as long as they can undergo some form of fusion. Because fusion is going to push outwards. It's going to create pressure that expands the star outwards, and meanwhile, gravity is continuing to crush it inwards. So, as we talked about a couple of lectures ago when we talked about specifically the sun, this provides the equivalent of a solar thermostat or a stellar thermostat, if we're extending this to talk about other stars, keeping the star's core temperatures in check, allowing fusion to happen at a steady rate for some period of time, depending on how fast that fusion is actually taking place. For a star like our sun and for other low-mass stars, this can continue for billions and billions of years. The amount of hydrogen required to actually make this happen isn't extended to the entire interior of the star. It's only the 10% of the star's volume that's placed at the very, very center, the very heart of the star. That's the star's fuel tank, in a sense. However long you can keep fusion going is dependent on how much hydrogen is there and the rate in which that hydrogen is being converted into helium. So now, with the onset of fusion, we've entered into step two, of course. Step two being the main sequence lifespan of a star. These main sequence stars, like our sun, like 90%+ of all of the stars that are out there in the universe that we can see currently, are doing this, are converting hydrogen into helium, and that's sort of just the normal part of the star's lifespan. Imagine it as being somewhat comparable to the amount of time you spend on the surface of the Earth where you can breathe without the aid of some machine, without life support, when you're in sort of the normal part of your lifetime, from when you're born to right before you die, right before you're put on life support and they put you on some kind of breathing machine that allows you to breathe with the aid of that machine. So this is a really crucial part of a star's overall lifespan, this main sequence lifespan, especially for a star like our sun that has a relatively limited post-main sequence lifespan. Now, let's talk about the sad fate that awaits a gas cloud that's not massive enough to collapse inwards and actually generate a star, because it happens. If you start with a relatively small gas cloud in space, if you just don't have a tremendous amount of mass there to begin with, then no matter how much gravity crushes that material inwards, you never reach core temperatures that are hot enough to start fusion. And that's on about a million Kelvin. See, if you never get to those core temperatures, then fusion never takes place. You never combat the internal collapse of gravity, and gravity continues to crush this material in and in and in. And the result isn't a black hole, because that requires a lot of other forces to be outweighed by the force of gravity. It takes a tremendous amount of mass to create something like a black hole. Only the death throes of something like a high-mass star can produce a black hole. What's instead formed is something that's very, very similar to the planet Jupiter in our own solar system. It's an object made primarily out of hydrogen and helium, crushed inwards by gravity, but it doesn't shine like a star because fusion isn't taking place. In astronomy, this object gets a name. It's called a brown dwarf. It's basically an object that is not very hot. It's going to cool off over time, and gravity just crushed it as far as it can. It's a very, very dense object, but still not dense enough and not hot enough for the onset of fusion. Now, if you do have enough mass there and enough density to have high enough temperatures that fusion ultimately began, then fusion will take place at some particular rate in our star, in our sun. That rate is 600 million tons of hydrogen converted to 596 million tons of helium every second for 4.5 billion years so far and another 5 billion years to go approximately. So that's the overall lifespan, the main sequence lifespan of a star like our sun, approximately about 10 billion years. A star's lifetime, a star's main sequence lifetime, is very, very much dependent on its mass, because the mass is going to determine the rate in which fusion takes place. The mass is going to determine density. Density determines core temperature, and core temperature determines how fast those fuel reserves are used up. Now, while it's a really easy jump to assume, okay, a high mass star would have a bigger fuel tank. It would have more hydrogen. And so that star must be able to be alive much longer than a low mass star. That doesn't end up actually being the case, because high mass stars are going to be very fuel inefficient in a sense, of comparing them to cars. A low mass star like our sun would be like some really fuel efficient vehicle. You know, I don't pretend to know a whole lot about how cars work, but you can picture a car that maybe has a really good gas mileage, something like a Toyota Camry or a Prius or, you know, any of your little small compact sedans. The smaller cars might have a smaller fuel tank, something like maybe like a 12-gallon fuel tank, but they use that fuel really efficiently. And that's essentially what low-mass stars do when they undergo this type of fusion called the proton-proton chain. High-mass stars, not like our sun, high-mass stars that are relatively uncommon out there in the universe today, are like big, really fuel-inefficient vehicles. Think about some big Ford truck, like a Ford F-350 or a Hummer or something, some big giant vehicle that might have an enormous fuel tank, something like an army tank maybe. So maybe, you know, a 20-gallon fuel tank, but they only get maybe something like 8 miles to the gallon. They're very fuel inefficient in a sense. So high mass stars use the CNO cycle. And we'll talk about, we'll remind everybody sort of what the details of the CNO cycle are when we talk about those high mass stars. The result of all of this is that high mass stars actually have a very, very short lifetime. And I know 5 million years seems like a really long lifetime for us, humans, mere humans on Earth that have less than 100-year stay on the surface of this Earth. 5 million years sounds like a really long time, but it's nothing compared to the extensively long main sequence lifetime of a low mass star. A low-mass star can be around and be converting hydrogen into helium for up to 10 billion years. So the difference between 5 million and 10 billion is pretty significant. When you get to numbers that big, they almost all sound the same. It almost all sounds like the national debt, you know, just numbers that are kind of unimaginable to us. But 10 billion is effectively 10,000 million. And so that makes this 2,000 times longer main sequence lifetime for a low mass star than a high mass star. Now, while the high mass stars might have a very short main sequence lifetime, they go on to do really amazing things with their extensively high core temperatures in the post main sequence lifetime. And that's what really makes the high mass stars interesting, the kind of elements that they can forge in their incredibly hot interiors. So we'll concentrate on the low mass stars for now. A low mass star like our sun is, even though it has been around for 4.5 billion years, that only takes it less than halfway through its overall lifespan. The Earth's interior will cool off. Earth will no longer be habitable by the time our star is no longer a main sequence star. So we have another 5.5 billion years to go before our star runs out of fuel, going through that slow conversion of converting hydrogen into helium through the proton-proton chain. So after 10 billion years, we're going to just kind of hit the fast forward button here because it's the same thing is happening at the same rate, allowing the star to be stable for an incredibly long period of time. But after that's over, after 10 billion years has passed for a low mass star like our sun, then something really interesting is going to happen right at the end of its lifespan. Carl Sagan once referred to this as almost being similar to a premonition of death. With these kind of death throes of the star, these giant phases that a star like our sun will go through right before it stops fusion altogether and ends its days as a nebula. So this main sequence lifespan can only continue this main sequence lifespan can only continue as long as there is hydrogen in the core of the star. But after 10 billion years of converting 600 million tons of hydrogen into 596 million tons of helium every second of every year for 10 billion years, that fuel is essentially going to be used up in the 10% core of the star in the very, very center. That hydrogen will be gone and it will be replaced with helium. And unless a star has high enough temperatures to go on to the next stage of helium fusion, then this is where it's going to end. But a star like our sun actually does have high enough core temperatures, we think, to go on to convert helium into even heavier elements. And that takes us to sort of step three, what I'm calling the post-main sequence lifetime. To make it analogous to your lifetime, you'd have to think about that short period of time at the very end of your life when you're on a respirator in a hospital where you've run out of the ability to breathe oxygen on your own. So this post-main sequence lifetime for a low-mass star like our sun will ultimately require taking helium, the helium in the core of the star, and doing something with it and converting it into a heavier element, continuing this process of fusion onto the next logical step. So as core hydrogen runs out, as the hydrogen in the 10% core of the star is used up and converted into helium, the first thing that a star is going to try to do to regain stability is to do what it's done all along and take the hydrogen somewhere else in the star and convert it into helium. Because temperatures are going to increase from the outside in, it's going to go to the next logical place to do this conversion, and that's just right outside the core in a little shell surrounding the core. That's where hydrogen will be converted into helium. And to make this happen, the star's core actually has to contract. The contraction of the core drives up the rate of fusion and makes the star really hot. The result of this is that the star can then expand because it's outdoing gravity for some short period of time. So the star expands to 30 times its original size. The secondary result of this expansion is that the surface of the star, being spread out across a much bigger area, will actually be cooler than it was before. So a star that's similar to our main sequence star today, the surface temperature 5800 Kelvin, will of course be yellow. It matches the surface temperature. A star that is the expanded result of a star like our sun with lower surface temperatures will not be yellow anymore. It will be a cooler, redder star. Okay, so one way of summing all of this up is that our star will turn into a red giant. And if it expands to truly 30 times its original size in space, that means it's going to take over a good chunk of the solar system along its way. Whole planets will be devoured by the expansion of the star. It will definitely include Mercury and Venus, and could possibly even include the Earth itself. So big chunks of our solar system will become part of the star. We are now an object that is within the star, part of the gravitational crunch within our star. So whole planets will be destroyed by the expansion of this object. Now, that's the first of these red giant phases. The star regains some stability because it's taken hydrogen and converting it into helium. Even if it's not in the core of the star anymore, it's fusion taking place somewhere in the star, and that's creating an external force that's combating the internal collapse of gravity. The second of these red giant phases, after the star kind of shrinks down a little bit, after fusion sort of wanes a little bit, is when the star figures out, in a sense, what to do with all that helium that's built up in the very, very core. The 10% of the star where fusion had always been taking place for billions of years is now full of helium. If the star is capable of converting that helium into something else, if it has high enough temperatures to be able to do so, it will do that, even if it requires gravity to collapse down the core just a little bit. So what you ultimately end up with is two different forms of fusion happening in a star. Hydrogen being converted into helium outside the core in a little nested shell, and helium being converted into stuff like carbon and oxygen within the core. One of the really awesome revelations that chemistry has given us is the idea that when you start to look at the structure of heavier elements, even stuff as heavy as silicon and sulfur and iron, it's really no different than some number of helium nuclei. Because all elements are made up of the same particles, electrons, protons, and neutrons, and their nuclei is what's actually determining the mass, then we can basically take some number of helium nuclei and glue them together, essentially go through this process of fusion, and make a whole bunch of different elements. Now, in the kind of temperatures that you get within a star like our sun and other low-mass stars, you really don't typically get past the point of forming some carbon and maybe some oxygen before you just don't have high enough temperatures to keep that fusion going anymore. So the main post-main sequence lifetime of a star like our sun will include the formation of a whole lot of carbon. So one reason why carbon is so abundant in the universe is because you can essentially just take three helium nuclei. And if you have three helium nuclei, you have six protons and six neutrons, because each one of those helium nuclei is made of two protons and two neutrons. If you glue them all together, essentially, through this force of fusion happening at astoundingly high temperatures, then you can convert that material into carbon. Carbon is simply an element with six protons. That's what makes it carbon, and it has 12 as its atomic number because it has a total number of protons and neutrons that equal out to 12. You're also producing energy, and you're producing an outwards pressure that's not allowing the star to collapse in on itself, at least not yet. What you can also do through a similar set of reactions, except it involves four helium nuclei instead of three, is form the element oxygen. Oxygen is just something with 8 protons and 16, normally, 16 protons and neutrons, an atomic mass of 16. And so what you've effectively done when you've glued together or fused together four helium nuclei is just form oxygen. The math with two helium nuclei doesn't really work out to create something that's very, very stable. So lithium and beryllium on the periodic table are probably the result of fission reactions, kind of backstepping the periodic table to form those elements. So hydrogen is converted into helium. Helium is converted into stuff like carbon and oxygen. And carbon and oxygen are really crucial in high mass stars and being able to use the CNO cycle to go through hydrogen to helium conversion. So as long as you can keep the basic story here, if I lost you with a little bit of this chemistry, the basic story here is that as long as you can keep fusion going in the core of the star is at least somewhat stable still. But as soon as you run out of core hydrogen, because hydrogen is the most abundant element in the universe, the star is on a limited time. It has a limited capacity to keep this going for a very long period of time. So that helium is quickly converted into carbon and oxygen, and a star like our sun doesn't have the core temperatures to be able to take that carbon and oxygen and then do anything even more sophisticated with it, build anything else that's even bigger. Because the more advanced the form of fusion, the higher the core temperatures have to be, and the more massive a star has to be in order to have those higher temperatures. So a star like our sun will build up an incredible amount of high-pressure carbon, maybe some oxygen as well, in the very, very, very core. Hydrogen will still be converted to helium elsewhere in the star, but the star will ultimately run out of the capacity to keep this going. A star like our sun can't go on to the fusion of heavier elements and do anything with that buildup of carbon and oxygen. And building up a heavy element that the star can't do anything with is like building up plaque and building up material in your heart, and it will ultimately shut you down. Building this material up in the very core of a star is equivalent to doing that same thing to your heart. If fusion can't continue to happen, and fusion is like the heart being able to pump blood in your body, then the star will ultimately run out of the ability to undergo fusion. If it's not undergoing fusion, then it's dead in a sense. So this is how a star dies, by exploding and imploding at the same time, by this final push of gravity that's going to do what it had been trying to do already. So gravity is like the grim reaper of space. It's ultimately going to kill off a star by crushing it inwards, by having the star build up material that it can't do anything with, and so the core will then collapse. Now, the collapse of the core will actually create an explosion, and the result of that explosion is something that we call a planetary nebula. So that's what I mean by the idea that it's exploding and imploding at the same time. When the star sheds all of its outer layers of hydrogen and helium back out into space, that force, that expansion of all that hydrogen and helium back out into space, actually creates the kind of nebula in which a new star can form. It's hot for a while, it cools off over time, it collapses back on itself, and it starts the process all over again. And these nebulas, especially when they first form and they're really hot and highly visible, are extraordinarily beautiful. This first picture of a nebula is the Ring Nebula in the Lyra constellation. It's absolutely gorgeous. In the very cores of these planetary nebulas, sometimes you can even see that immense ball of carbon and maybe sometimes oxygen that gets left behind, the result of gravity crushing the heart of the star inwards. And that white dwarf is also visible for some period of time because it also is extremely hot. They cool off over time and they're not undergoing fusion, but at least initially they're hot enough to be able to be seen. So they're the hot bones of a dead star. So we have the Eskimo Nebula, the Spirograph Nebula, and then finally, this one's my favorite, this is probably the trippiest overall, the so-called Hourglass Nebula. So all of these different planetary nebula all have all of these different shapes, different colors, because of the different ways that these stars can actually expand outwards and the differences in temperature in all of these outer layers of gas. So the leftover bones of the star that get left behind is the result of the collapse of gravity. And what gravity is essentially doing is collapsing the very core of the star. What was left behind after all that fusion took place was maybe a little bit of helium built up around the core, but mainly just a big ball of carbon, maybe a little bit of oxygen in there as well, if you have a sufficiently high mass enough star. So a star like our sun might also be capable of forming some oxygen as well as a whole bunch of carbon. So what you have here essentially is extremely dense carbon. And if you remember anything from 101, from Earth Science 101, if you happen to have taken that before you took this class, you might know what high pressure carbon is. At least on Earth, the high pressure form of the element carbon is diamond. So these things really realistically could be whole planet-sized objects composed entirely of diamond, essentially, a high-pressured carbon. And they're extremely hot for a while, meaning they're visible from a great distance, but they're going to cool off over time. So as more and more and more of the mass of the universe gets locked up in these stellar remnants, there's less available to form stars. It gives you a little glimpse into the future of the universe as it continues to expand and stellar evolution continues to take place. So one thing I'll mention about these white dwarfs is that what holds them up against the crush of gravity that would actually allow for something like a black hole to form is electron degeneracy pressure. And what that means basically is that gravity has crushed the core of the star into something as small as entire atoms will allow it to be crushed into. So gravity is crushing this until the electrons can't be pushed together anymore and whole atoms can't be pushed together anymore and compacted together anymore. And so you have whole atoms squeezed together as much as they possibly could. As much as the mass of our entire sun could be locked up in the form of this white dwarf. So it could have a mass similar to the mass of our entire sun, it's quite a bit larger, but it's crushed down into something the size of a planet like Earth. Imagine Earth being such a very, very small component of our solar system as being as dense as our entire star is. And that gives you a glimpse of how dense these stellar remnants can eventually become. And so that's what happens at the very center, where the core of the star used to be. Everything else gets expanded outwards into a planetary nebula that could collapse back in on itself again and form a new star. But forever after that, much of the mass of that star is actually still locked up in the form of that white dwarf. Now, in cases where you have an even higher mass star, whole atoms can be ripped apart by the aftermath, by the death throes, by something called a supernova. And much of this matter can be squeezed even tighter to form these things called either neutron stars or ultimately potentially even black holes. And so these are going to be, these even more dense stellar remnants are going to be the result of only high mass stars. And that's what we're going to end off talking about in the next lecture. Before we get there, I wanted to share something with you from not the newer version of the TV show Cosmos, where we've pulled a couple of clips from before, starring Neil deGrasse Tyson, but the original version of Cosmos from 1980. So I just think that Carl Sagan in this clip does a really amazing job talking about these stellar remnants, talking about what holds up essentially a white dwarf versus a neutron star versus a black hole, and what kind of conditions would allow for all of these different stellar remnants to form. So I hope you enjoy it.
It is the destiny of stars to collapse. Of the thousands of stars you see when you look up at the night sky, every one of them is living in an interval between two collapses. An initial collapse of a dark interstellar gas cloud to form the star, and a final collapse of a luminous star on the way to its ultimate fate. Gravity makes stars contract unless some other force intervenes. The sun is an immense ball of radiating hydrogen. The hot gas in its interior tries to make the sun expand. The gravity tries to make the sun contract. And the present state of the sun is the balance of these two forces, an equilibrium between gravity and nuclear fire. In this long middle age between collapses, the stars steadily shine. But when the nuclear fuel is exhausted, the interior cools, the pressure is no longer enough to support its outer layers, and the initial collapse resumes. There are three ways that stars die. Their fates are predestined. Everything depends on their initial mass. A typical star with a mass like the sun will one day continue its collapse until its density becomes very high. And then the contraction is stopped by the mutual repulsion of the overcrowded electrons in its interior. A collapsing star twice as massive as the sun isn't stopped by the electron pressure, and it goes on folding in on itself until nuclear forces come into play, and they hold up the weight of the star. But a collapsing star three times as massive as the Sun isn't stopped even by nuclear forces. There's no force known that can withstand this enormous compression. And such a star has an astonishing destiny. It continues to collapse until it vanishes utterly. So every star is characterized by the force that holds it up against gravity. A star that's supported by the gas pressure is a normal run-of-the-mill star like the Sun. A collapsed star that's held up by electron forces is called a white dwarf. It's a Sun shrunk to the size of the Earth. A collapsed star supported by nuclear forces is called a neutron star. It's a Sun shrunk to the size of a city. And a star so massive that in its final collapse it disappears altogether is called a black hole. It's a Sun with no size at all.
All right, so that's going to wrap up specifically low-mass stars, and that's going to segue us into the next subject, where we do all of these same life stages, except we apply them to high-mass stars. And we'll see why high-mass stars, even though they're in the minority, why even though they're incredibly rare in the universe today, why they are so inspiring, and why they are so important, and why their remnants are even weirder and more interesting than things like white dwarfs. All right, so that's all we're going to do today. Until next time, keep looking up.